Please subscribe, like and share our videos. Exclusive content brought to you here on Latif Yahia's channel only. Chapter 1. Recalled from the Frontline. On the morning of 23rd of September 1987, I'm sitting in a shiny black Mercedes limousine with tinted windows. My chauffeur doesn't speak. The dark leather smells fresh. I think to myself that the car must be new, no dust, no stains. The carpets on the floor are spotless and the dashboard and trims are made with the finest wood veneer. As we glide along, there's little noise from the engine or air conditioning. We arrive in the grounds of the Palace of the Republic in Baghdad. The size of a normal European city, it contains ministries, ministerial apartments, sports fields, theaters, hospitals, cinemas and an airport. There are beautiful parks with fabulous fountains in between, azure-blue swimming pools with marble rims. A city within a city. The impressive nerve center of Saddam Hussein's secret Iraq. Having no idea why I have been taken here, I'm frightened, but I have no intention of asking the chauffeur anything. Besides, there's another black limousine directly behind us. I was never frightened fighting at the front, but now the sweat is forming on my face and trickling down my back like condensation on a wintry window. Wiping my hands on my army fatigues, I ask myself, why me? Have I done something? The worrying fact is people are always disappearing in Iraq. We don't always know the real reason that they are arrested, tortured, imprisoned for life, or summarily executed. All we have are rumors, theories. But there's one thing all Iraqis know for certain, an obscene gesture about the president or his family, a joke, even a whispered word in the wrong ear could be your death sentence. Saddam has made it clear, everything you could ask for Iraq provides, in return, never disrespect his family or take his chair. I know I've always been loyal to the regime, but I still have an uneasy sense of insecurity. It's gnawing at my mind, eating deeper and deeper the longer I spend in the blacked-out Mercedes. I start to think and question myself, have I ever criticized Saddam anywhere? At any time? Talking with friends, family, joking with comrades at the front. Have I ever made it known that I am repelled by this war? That I feel it's a waste of everyone's time and robbing me of my youth? Have I ever disobeyed an order, even indirectly, or worse still, failed to carry one out? On January 6, 1987, 9 months earlier, I was called up to do my compulsory military service. Having finished university with a first in law, it was only necessary for me, as part of the pride of Iraq, to serve 21 months, whereas those who didn't go to university or, for whatever reason, never finished their course were sent to the front for 36 months. The Iraq-Iran war was still going strong after 7 years. Our forces had taken 1,800 square kilometers of Iranian territory. Along the Iran-Iraq border, more than 40 of our divisions concentrated in the Shatt al-Arab southern Iraq, the estuary of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. While at university, I hadn't noticed the war so much, mainly because I had no interest but also because there was only an occasional missile that hit Baghdad, one destroying two shops in the city center. But I hated the army from the first day, especially as I knew my service could easily be extended from 21 months up to 10 years if the fatherland needed me. Laws in Iraq could change on the president's whim. If he decided he was short of soldiers, he simply changed the law to extend your service. No military expert in Iraq, certainly not a regular citizen like me, could see an end to the Iran-Iraq border dispute. All we knew about it was that Saddam wanted the waterway and Iran wanted it as well. The two countries were at deadlock. Literally. My friends and family had been fighting in this war for years. There were very few families who had not sacrificed at least one beloved son in this ridiculous conflict. Everywhere in Baghdad were the war wounded, amputees, burn victims. The full horror of war etched on human faces. Young men with empty souls and deep expressionless eyes. In marked contrast, you'd see the healthy young men with Kalashnikovs waiting for their buses to take them back to base or the front, all trying to ignore a snapshot of their possible fate hobbling by on crutches or unrecognizable through a melted mask that was once a face. While at university, I'd drive through Baghdad, the beautiful city that it was, but I'd never stop or talk to these men. At that time their war was not mine, but I could sense that not many felt any patriotic zeal to continue the battle. But it was their duty, and refusal or desertion carried a death sentence. That was what our president, Saddam Hussein, had decreed for the duration of the war, which was now in its seventh year. Thousands of deserters had already been killed, in the Al-Amariya camps, in prison number 1, in the Al-Rashid camp in Baghdad. There had been mass executions performed in full view of the public. Saddam didn't wish them to be hidden behind prison walls or in killing fields, he wanted them on live television. His goal? Deterrence and intimidation. His thinking was that those who considered desertion would not only have to think about their own deaths, but the humiliation, disgrace and desperation of their families who they would leave behind. Whole families were made to watch the executions of their loved ones. Scenes reminiscent of Tyburn in England, in the Middle Ages, or the French Revolution in the 1790s. But this was current-day Iraq. Mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers stood powerless in despair as the traitors to the fatherland were hanged. The victims were intended to feel the torments of their children and relatives as though it were happening to them as well. So they were also tainted by dishonor and degradation. And would suffer nightmares for the rest of their lives. Even that torture was not enough. On top of that, the families had to pay a fine to the state, as a compensation for their son's guilt. A decent burial was also prohibited. A deserter has failed the president and Allah, they sneered, he has lost his honor. Of course, President Saddam Hussein never described this barbaric cruelty as deterrence, which it was, just punishment for godless people was his preferred term. Being a university graduate, I joined a special commando unit. Our trainer's task was to turn this band of soft, privileged recruits, the Ayyad Saad, into officers as quickly as possible. His aim was to produce officers capable of assuming leadership tasks within 4 months. I was given the training number 23. Our course was called Saddam the Arab, on the 16th of January 1987, in the Al-Rashid barracks on the outskirts of Baghdad, I began my training. For the first month we had nothing but drill, to the point of exhaustion. It was 24 hours of intensive brainwashing. We were woken at 4 a.m., roll call inspection was an hour later, then the issuing of orders, followed by physical training, exercise and yet more physical training. Naked from the waist up, wearing only our uniform trousers, we were hurried across the dusty barracks yard where we did endless repetitions of sit-ups, squats and running on the spot. We rushed over the obstacle course, crawled across the hot, sticky asphalt. Salim al-Juburi was the worst of our trainers, a dark-skinned man from the south of Iraq. He yelled abuse and hit us if we didn't carry out our exercises instantly and to the letter. He treated us like animals. We hated him and he had no favorites. It was Salim who had drilled the 200 Moroccan soldiers, our Muslim brothers who were training in Baghdad, until they could stand upright no longer. I understood why. Lunch was at 2 p.m. Then it would start all over again. Drill, gymnastics, exercising, political training. Without a break, without any downtime, not a second to think of anything except the army and your duties. If you refused, your punishment would be laps around the parade grounds until Salim was satisfied or you collapsed. The trainer's objective was to break us. Break our personalities, drain our humanity dry and turn us from sociable humans into less fighting machines. During this time, we were prohibited from having any contact with family or friends. Telephone calls and even letters were forbidden. No distractions were allowed. Only after the first month of this indoctrination were we allowed home for 48 hours, 2 days of trying to be human again. Then came the second round, the military part of the course. We joined another company, the Al-Sa'ika. Here we learned to use light arms, attack weapons. How to dismantle the famous Kalashnikov, to load, clean and remove obstructions. Repeatedly we would, dismantle, clean, reassemble, dismantle, clean and reassemble again and again and again. Until we became so proficient that we could clean and operate it in our sleep. Karate and self-defense came next. Hand-to-hand combat and street fighting. We were trained in stealth and the use of close proximity weapons. We were taught how to stalk and kill an enemy silently with a knife. The course came to an end with survival training. They'd saved the worst till last. At first, we spent hours and then whole days without food and water. That was bad enough, but it was only then we faced the most repugnant ordeal. We were marched into a vast room that could have held 1,000 people. It was disgusting beyond belief. A muddy floor with puddles of stagnant water. There were rotting carcasses of dead dogs and cats, all full of wriggling maggots, strewn about everywhere. The stench was beyond foul, a breath-catching mix of decaying animals, shit, urine and stale sweat. I held my breath, but when I couldn't any longer, I tried to breath through my mouth rather than my nose. My plan failed. Not even a tramp who had slept rough for years could get used to the repugnant stink. Thousands of men had gone before us and had lost themselves, the world and God in that room. 500 of us were locked in there together. The trainers sat like tennis umpires on high chairs to oversee our fall from humanity and our futile attempts to endure this living hellhole. Everywhere I looked there were cockroaches, beetles, horseflies, even snakes were thrown into the mix. We were ordered to jump into the puddles, stamp on the rotting dead dog and cat carcasses, and to eat live cockroaches. Solidarity and friendship were extinguished. Anyone who refused was set upon by his former friends and beaten and kicked for practice. We spent a week in that room. It was a battle for personal survival that some could not cope with. A tall, skinny colleague of mine from university called Satar, nearly died when the trainer shouted, "Satar, eat those cockroaches. Catch them, eat them." Satar caught two cockroaches, each one as big as a matchbox. He squeezed them together until the milky fluid of their innards seeped onto his hand. "Put them in your mouth, Satar. Put them in your mouth and chew," yelled the trainer. Satar couldn't do it. He retched, his body twitching as he tried not to vomit. He conquered his urge 3 or 4 times, but as the tears welled up in his eyes, the vomit projected like a fountain from his mouth. As he fell slowly to his knees, vomiting and retching, the trainer yelled, "Pick him up. Pick up that sack of shit." We knew what had to be done. Two men grabbed him under the arms and hoisted the still vomiting Satar up. A third soldier held his head while another began shoving cockroaches into his mouth, while vomit was still escaping. "Bite them, chew them, you're an Iraqi soldier," came the call from the high chair in an almost joyous tone. Satar chewed and then threw up again. More cockroaches were forced into his mouth. There was a crunching sound as he bit down, then his whole body shuddered as he swallowed the creatures. Although the course brought me on and made me a man, it also took a lot out of me. I was, however, in excellent physical condition afterwards and, as my brain had been completely switched off, my body worked in a completely autonomous way that is hard to describe. Order, compliance and no backchat. I was able to carry out 60-kilometer route marches with a full pack, hardly noticing any physical discomfort. Every fiber of my body was working and my brain showed no resistance to the strain. We were gladiators and the inhumane training had toughened our will as hard as a Kalashnikov barrel. "The supreme goal," the trainers would bellow at us, "is for you to become brutal, inhumane, like animals. Even the Israeli Secret Service is afraid of you, you should be proud. The world must fear you and you must forget your fear." We felt like an elite force and the system constantly reinforced that belief and gave us fresh confidence. "You are a team," they told us, "you are young men that have been chosen. You have had every opportunity to become what we want you to be. You have the unique opportunity to serve your country in a way that is granted to very few. Right now you are only the raw material for your ultimate duties, but when we're finished with you, you will be the best qualified soldiers in the world." Basic training ended on April 5, 1987. We were granted 4 days precious leave. My first thought was of home and my family. My father was proud that his eldest son had successfully completed his training and seemed to have enjoyed it. I was happy he was happy, but I was really in two minds. While I felt revulsion at the war and was opposed to it, I was also fascinated by the weaponry I'd been exposed to. In the Arab world, weapons are a part of every man's life. They are more than mere instruments of death, they are an expression of strength and resolution, of power and wealth. It's customary in Iraq for every man to carry a firearm. Like a washing machine in other parts of the world, no Arab family home is complete without one, whether it's a pistol, a rifle or Kalashnikov. A man without a weapon is no man. That's what Saddam taught us. In talking with my father, I gave little away about my past weeks of training. Instead, we talked about the forthcoming month of training. Parachute jumps were on the agenda. I was excited. Within 30 days, we were expected to be able to jump from planes and carry out guerrilla attacks behind enemy lines. Our chief instructor was rough and rock hard, totally imbued with the regime's ideology, but he was also a soldier's soldier. Because of him, we weren't afraid of the first jump, as he reminded us that we were the elite, the best Iraq had. We should only think about our job. You must become familiar with fear, he told us in a fatherly fashion. When you know fear, you can overcome it. The jump platform was in the center of the barracks and towered 120 or so meters high. The iron rungs to the top seemed endless to us, but the instructors harried us ruthlessly. Hesitating earned two lashes. At the top, I tottered with my training parachute strapped to my back and looked over the edge. I was scared, but a voice boomed over the loudspeaker, "Whoever refuses to jump will repeat the whole course." The choice was an easy one: jump. Don't be afraid, be strong, concentrate. I tensed my muscles, took a deep breath, yelled "Al Saika," and plunged into the void. I made it. Saddam the Arab, as our course was called, ended on May 9, 1987. Surprisingly, only 60 of the 500 men who started the course had given up. They had either been eliminated as officer candidates or had to repeat the whole course. The other 440 of us proudly collected our awards in dress uniforms, lined up on the parade ground. An army band played the Iraqi national anthem. To add to our sense of pride and elitism, Commander Abd al-Jadbar Shanchal came to personally hand us our certificates and inform us that we were now members of the Iraqi army. This was a proud day for me. I was only 23, yet already an Iraqi army officer. I'd taken my first career step within Iraqi society, which considers military prowess, along with money, as the most desirable attribute in a young man. I felt happy with myself and, to top it all off, I was given another 4 days leave. I went back home to my parents' house, but this visit wasn't as happy and carefree as the previous one had been. For, at the same time as I was decorated for the successful completion of my officer's training, I was also given my marching orders. And I was to be posted straight to the front line. Images of the disfigured, disabled ex-soldiers preyed on my mind. The horrors they'd endured made even the worst moments of my training seem like a holiday in paradise. And that holiday was now over. The 13th of May 1987 was a blazing hot day. We were taken by army bus from Baghdad to Mosa ibn Nasir, home of the 35th Division. The unit was located east of Basra, in southern Iraq. The commander was Mohammed Tahir Tafiq, an affable man whom I knew personally because he came from the same Baghdad suburb as I did, Al-Adamiya. When we arrived, I was unsettled, exhausted and very unsure of what to expect. Mohammed Tahir Tafiq took it all in, but the days of reassurance were over. "You have 24 hours to rest from your trip, then you'll be transferred to the front," he boomed in a deep voice. No additional comment was forthcoming. The barracks had several subterranean levels, similar to an underground car park. I didn't sleep well that night. The heat, the mosquitoes, the shelling, which, to my surprise, we could hear, all bothered me greatly. I was listening to the ominous sounds of war. Frightening sounds I was hearing for the first time in my life. Our side returned fire and I could feel the vibrations. There was no turning back now. The smell of war was in my nose. I was a part of it. The next day, as my commander had promised, I was transferred to observation post number 5-2 in Al-Azir. The post was situated in a region of marshes. Our enemies, the Iranians, or Khomeinis, as we called them, were no more than 3 kilometers away. If the wind was blowing towards us, you could hear them talking in their positions. It often wasn't polite conversation. They would threaten to cut our throats when they overran our lines. Sometimes they shouted out to us, "Jaish May Akram." May Akram was a cabaret singer who performed in Baghdad's seediest venues. Even in liberal-minded Iraq, where alcohol, bars and nightclubs were as common as in the United States and Europe, May Akram had a terrible reputation and was the subject of many lewd jokes. What the Khomeinis were calling us basically translates as a godless army of whores. There was nothing remotely romantic about my duties. During our training, a picture had been built for us of a romantic image of war. I quickly learned it didn't exist. My job, or orders, were observation of the enemy troops and radio transmission of the coded results of the observation. My observation post was a raised platform poised on six poles surrounded by marsh and only accessible by boat. Inside, were two tiny benches that also served as beds, a table on which we kept our radio, and in the corner was a tiny cooking area. The whole platform was no more than 3 square meters. This was where I was to hold out in our glorious war against Khomeini. My team consisted of radio officer Ismail Taha, a hardened warrior, not much older than me but already a veteran of several years on the front. There was also Muhammad Mater, a simple soldier from a Baghdad suburb. We also had a cook which seemed ridiculous for a company of 2 soldiers. I had to keep that position for 21 days which we filled with monotonous routine. Watching, watching, and more watching. It was more than dull. Even the slightest change in the enemy positions had to be reported back to command, who then responded with heavy artillery fire. We only had light arms and stood no chance of fighting off any attack. Should the Khomeinis advance in strength, our orders were to withdraw calmly and quietly. For weeks, I got used to watching and reporting interspersed with brief periods of intense artillery battles. Then back to watching again. Of the enemy, I saw mercifully little. Trucks bringing food rations, not even those normally, just the dust they threw up as they sped to the positions. Sometimes, mostly at night, the Khomeinis seemed so close we could hear them breathe. Then there were days when we saw and heard nothing of them, although we knew they were out there. It was tense and dull simultaneously. Both sides had become mired down in positional warfare, trench warfare, and it looked like the stalemate would continue indefinitely. Despite the potential danger, I soon grew tired of sitting and waiting like an expectant father outside a maternity ward. Boxed in, the blue sky above, the marshy water below, the unbearable heat all around, and nothing, nothing but more and more marshland and water in the Shat al-Arab. As an officer, I was better off than most, but it didn't feel that way. I ate what the others ate and slept on the same wooden benches. Just like them, I was only a tiny, insignificant, disposable cog in this great machine of war. Why was I here? I didn't hate the enemy. I didn't know them to hate them. Maybe, if there'd been some murderous dynamic, some real threat to me and my little unit out there in our little hut on stilts. But, as it was, the whole situation seemed absurd. Surreal, like a really dull nightmare. Maybe I just had too much time to think. But with 95% of my time spent watching, the situation seemed increasingly ridiculous. The one real advantage being an officer gave me was that every 3 weeks I had 7 precious days leave. After 21 long days and nights, I could finally go home and enjoy Baghdad, the city of my dreams. My family home was already large, but, after being in my shoebox for weeks, it seemed palatial. The thought of my bed was particularly appealing after all those nights on my wooden bench. I hugged my mother and talked with my father. He was very supportive about my time spent at the front. But even he couldn't help noticing that I was searching for some real reason to be there, a concrete reason for the war. "Look, Baba, Father, we have a good life, Iraqis have everything they need or want, look at our house. Why do we have to die in this war?" A loyal Iraqi, my father sidestepped my questions and gave me the standard, approved response. "Son, military service is your duty to the fatherland. Desertion is punishable by death." He made it clear there was no way out. I had to return to the front. I had to do my duty. 2 days later, on the 10th of June 1987, the Khomeinis attacked, giving me my baptism of fire. In a concerted attempt to wipe out the whole 35th Division, they came at us from all sides. Quickly, I ordered my radio officer to establish contact with headquarters. He yelled the alarm into the ether, and response came back. "Abandon your position. Pull back now." It was already too late. As we clambered down into our little boat, we could see Iranian helicopters approaching. At first just two, then a whole squadron. The enemy fire was like a wild pyrotechnic display. Suddenly, a shell exploded right by us, blasting our eardrums. Our little hut that had become our home from home was blown to kingdom come, fragments of it landing in the water all around us. A few minutes earlier and we would have suffered the same fate and ended up with a watery grave in the water of the marsh. But we were still far from safe. Although our artillery units were returning fire, the enemy were advancing further and further into what we considered out territory. We were hemmed in, there was no way out. We were determined to fight our way to the nearest base, but our nearest base commander was forced to surrender almost immediately. My whole company was captured. Officers and soldiers were separated. The Khomeinis bound our hands and herded us like cattle into a dank cellar where they beat us. Only six of them were assigned to guard us as the battle continued. Ghassan Hamoud, commander of the Iraqi 10th Tank Brigade and a decorated war hero, began a determined counteroffensive. His orders were clear, to free captured Iraqis and drive the Khomeinis back. He wasn't a man not to follow orders or to waste time. Just 2 hours later, the Khomeinis were retreating in panic back to where they'd started. They waded through the marshes, leaving their weapons and even our guards behind. What a crazy war. The military situation was reversed. The 10th Tank Brigade took hundreds of Iranian soldiers prisoner. The day that began as a humiliating defeat for the Iraqi army ended as a rousing victory. A delighted Saddam Hussein brought in his whole propaganda machine, television, newspaper reporters and photographers. We celebrated as if we'd won the war. Our whole unit received special decorations and I was promoted to first lieutenant. But in every battle there are casualties. Amongst the Iraqi soldiers celebrating, I was grieving. Nassim Tibn, a young soldier from the Anbar district of Baghdad who had gone trough training with me, was seriously injured in the counterattack, not by a bullet or grenade but by a rock. Nassim had been guarding an Iranian prisoner. The soldier lay face down on the ground with his hands behind his head. But he suddenly sprang up from the ground, smashing Nassim hard in the face with a rock. The wound was terrible with blood spurting into the sand. Nassim cried out in agony, covering his shattered face with his hands. One of my men reacted quickly. He drew his sidearm and shot the Iranian soldier in the chest. It was the first time I'd seen someone die. The Iranian fell to the ground but managed to crawl a few meters before twitching and losing consciousness. I heard the death rattle, a noise that I'll never forget, the unnatural sound of your last breath escaping your body. It was somehow undignified to see him lying there in his faded uniform, cruel and callous to be shot like that. I should have felt pity, but deep down I felt glad. He deserved it. A few days later, on the 25th of July 1987, I was transferred to an artillery division, Unit 954, which was also right at the front. We were well armed, all our equipment was Soviet made and included the most advanced 85mm mortars, with a range of about 3 kilometers or slightly more. My squadron leader, Mohammed Ghalib, was a pleasant man who had carried out hundreds of attacks in the war. I was pleased to have been assigned to such an experienced officer. Lieutenant Nasir Baker and Lieutenant Saad Ahmad, who were both from Baghdad and also of good families, were more modern in their thinking than any Harvard MBA student. Both tall, slender, in excellent physical condition and sporting obligatory mustaches, they were the epitome of Iraqi officers. I soon became their friend, although at first I could see no reason as to why they had taken me into their group so warmly. I was present when discussions of position were carried out. I ate with the other officers in the command post. Our position consisted of a network of subterranean tunnels, supported by wooden poles and reinforced with sandbags. The command post was small, slightly claustrophobic but somewhat charming all the same. We called it the restaurant. A few small tables, chairs and a little cooking area in the corner. Everything was pretty Spartan but I felt good here. Suddenly, I had access to those glorified higher military circles, a world so full of itself that reality, the horrors of war, seemed remote. For the first time I had influence, I felt a sense of power, I was one of the hierarchy giving the orders. The protocol was clear: issue orders, whilst taking every care necessary not to go too far. Never cross the invisible boundaries. Never make a mistake. And, most important of all, never give offense to those who really have the final say in Iraq, the members of Saddam's all-powerful clan. No little jokes. No discourteous remarks about the president. No criticism of his family or their lackeys and lickspittles. As I have said, I couldn't explain why they had taken to me so well and drawn me into their circle so quickly. Ignorance is bliss. But one day, Mohammed Ghalib let the secret slip and I finally understood. We were drinking a glass of chai, tea, while talking about mundane matters, when Ghalib drew me toward him in a fatherly way. He took my right hand, raised his glass to me and with a smile said, almost in a whisper, "You have good connections to the influential circles in Baghdad. You're one of them." I said nothing but smiled as if I knew what he was talking about and took a sip of my chai. At that moment it hit me, it became crystal clear. They all believed that I was a member of the Hussein family because I happened to be the spitting image of Saddam's eldest son, Uday. In reality, not one of them knew what Uday looked like. They had never met him and only seen the photos that had been used in the newspapers and on television. Those photos weren't particularly good quality. None of them had direct access to the president's family, so nobody was able to check out my credentials. Ghalib was so convinced I was a member of the clan that he proposed I become the unit's political leader. It was a huge honor for someone so young, a special distinction, but one which I had to turn down as I didn't belong to the Ba'ath Party, whose members are higher up in the military ranks than mere military men. In the end, the job went to a young lieutenant sent by the Ba'ath Party in Baghdad. I didn't especially care and, anyway, I had no time to dwell on the matter. On the 20th of September 1987, there was a sudden excitement within the officers in my unit. A secret and urgent cable had come from the office of the president, a highly unusual event. And it concerned me. Ghalib called me into his office, "Yahia, have you done something? Have you broken the law?" I was surprised and alarmed. "No, never, why?" Ghalib grinned superciliously and then said in his warm, paternal air, "Yahia, you must go to Baghdad, as quickly as possible, it's an important secret mission." I wanted to ask Ghalib more details but he dismissed me with an elegant yet self-important wave of his hand, "No questions Yahia, my friend, off you go." He said it with a broad, all-knowing grin but, the fact was, he knew nothing. 24 hours later, I was in headquarters in Baghdad. It was 6 p.m. and I was tired and tense. I was still in my uniform. It was soiled from the front, dusty, with creases no tailor would approve of and sweat stains from my journey. The aircon had lost the battle with the heat and my anxiety. At reception, party member Kaiser Harb al-Tikriti was waiting. He told me to sit and wait as I would have another short journey. I'd been sitting long enough so I stood with him. The uneasy silence was broken by him asking me about how life was in the front line. "Fine, I'm proud to be fighting for my country," I lied. Telling him what he wanted to hear and because lying is a form of self-preservation in Iraq. Everyone lies because lies have become part of our society's convention. He just nods in reply and I'm happy with that. After 10 minutes, the black Mercedes pulls up outside. The expressionless chauffeur holds open the back door for me and we set off again heading for the palace grounds just a few streets away. I turn to look out the rear window and see another Mercedes is following us like a puma stalking its prey. I see three men are in it, their faces grave. I know I'm caught in the middle of something serious but what? Ordinary arrests are carried out in Iraq with much less decorum. I return to my original thought. What have I done wrong? We've been gliding effortlessly along for 5 very long minutes now but I'm in no mood to appreciate the car's luxury ride. I ask the chauffeur if he's got a cigarette. His answer's a curt no. My military service record flashes through my mind as if in a film. Question after question is asked by my subconsciousness. Have I questioned the war in any way? Have I criticized the president? I remember the conversation I had with my father when I was on leave. No. No, it couldn't be that. My father would never betray me, never. Nor would any other member of my family. At least, not intentionally. Had someone else overheard? The eyes and ears of Saddam's clan are everywhere. But in my family's dining room? Of course not. It must be something else. Think. Why did Commander Gollop go on about the president's family to me? Had he been testing me, checking my loyalty? Were his references to my similarity to Uday some kind of trick? Was he trying to test my loyalty? Had I not praised the regime enough? I give up trying to find an answer. I'm about to ask the chauffeur if he knows what's happening, but notice he's just staring at the asphalt road. He won't know or care, probably, but it's worth a try. I'm sitting diagonally behind him. I slide myself over the leather seat directly into his eyeline in the rearview mirror and I stare at him, trying to attract his attention. It works. He catches my glance and strokes his black mustache. I'm about to ask a question when I think better of it. I might not like his answer. If he answers, I tell myself I'm paranoid. I try to reassure myself that it's probably all a mistake. But even if it is, that might not save me. Everyone in Baghdad knows that innocent people are regularly accused and executed due to mistakes and the cruelty of the president's family. Just a few weeks ago, onlookers had streamed along Rashid Street, Baghdad's main shopping center. Four men were on display, their hands and feet bound with chains. They were escorted by armed soldiers who handed them over to a furious public. For an hour, hysterical women screamed abuse at them, pulled their hair and spat into their frightened faces. Then the unfortunate men stumbled off straight to the scaffold. The offenders were Baghdad businessmen who had been sentenced to death by Saddam Hussein. At the time, Saddam had appeared on television, which we could receive at the front, and said these low creatures had damaged the people through simple greed and sold goods at outrageous prices. Everyone knew it was a lie. Saddam's clan just wanted to get rid of its opponents who had infiltrated its social circles and dared to voice the obvious that the clan had the whole country by the throat in a grip of steel. These executions clearly revealed how frightened Saddam is of his own countrymen. But the people are also afraid of Saddam. We're all living in fear of each other. Like an idiot, I thought I'd learn to live within these rules. But I haven't. Now, without warning, everything has changed and I'm caught up in a spiral that drags everyone down. I'm a protagonist in a bloody drama called Iraq-My Homeland and a happy ending seemed unlikely. They must have got me confused with someone else, I think, to give myself courage and hope. I find myself even moving my lips. I'm sweating again and my shirt sticks to my skin. So now I'm paying for someone else's crime. Is this how my life will end? But it's just the beginning. My Mercedes stops outside the Nisr Baghdad Palace, the official building of Uday Saddam Hussein, Saddam's notorious son. I know the building, though I've never been here before, as I've seen it hundreds of times on television and in newspapers. Yes, it's Uday's palace, so this must be something to do with him. But what could Uday want with me? My chauffeur gets out and politely opens my door. Once again he never says a word and avoids looking me in the eye, his face blank and betraying nothing. Two uniformed men are waiting and escort me inside. I have to wait for 5 minutes or so standing in a kind of vestibule. On the wall hangs a big mirror. I see my reflection and no longer look the smart officer awarded his certificate on the parade ground. I daren't sit on the white leather furniture decorated with gold, fearing the dust on my uniform will stain it. It looks like everyone else has been too intimidated to sit on it as well. Suddenly, the door swings open and he's standing in front of me. He's grinning with a huge Havana cigar between his index and middle fingers. He's President Saddam's eldest son and heir, Uday Saddam Hussein. The first thing I think is, he's hardly changed. We could still be twins. Follow for the next chapter.